Welcome everybody. Last session of the day. So it's 2:29. Come on in, get settled. We'll start at 2:30. So we can be done on time, if not earlier. Feel free to sign in to any of the resources or the session, not required, but just if you'd like to, feel free to join me in any of these locations. All right, it's 2:30, so I'm gonna go ahead and jump in. Welcome everyone. Last session of the day, as I mentioned, I think we've all had very full days. This is my sixth session as well. So it's been quite a full day. So as you're getting settled and coming in, just wanted to, this may be, I think different speakers are using different platforms. So you guys may be sort of skipping around from platform to platform. This one is Zoom. And you'll see that you can communicate through chat. Would love to hear from you guys as you have questions or comments. You can also raise your hand and I can unmute you if you'd like to speak. That is welcome as well. And you'll see in front of you, by the way, I can't hear or see you. So you are mute just to try and keep all the background noise out of the discussion. But if you do want to speak, please raise your hand. Happy to unmute you. And I can't see you guys either at this moment, so that's a little sad for me, but hope you guys are doing all right out there. And you'll also see the slide in front of you, just tells you a little bit about what resources we're using today. So we've got Nearpod, the slideshow that we're gonna be going through that I've used to scaffold. My session is at Nearpod, so you're welcome to join the session now through this code. I'm also gonna be sharing you a copy of the slideshow so you can look at it down the road and review it if you'd like. So you don't need to join. Actually, let me take that back. If you guys could please go ahead and join it because we have a game in here. So yes, please go to join.nearpod.com and type in the code USGBK. We have a pretty small group, so it shouldn't take you too long to do that. But please do go on a separate, you know, browser tab, join.nearpod.com and type USGBK. Because this is game-based learning, so we're gonna have some gaming. So I need to be able to play along with you guys. So I'll give you a few minutes to do that. Join.nearpod.com and type USGBK, please. We're also gonna be spending a lot of time at pbslearningmedia.org. That is our main streaming service that we sponsor here at GPB. So we create our own content at gpb.org. We'll be looking at some of that content. And then we also sponsor PBS Learning Media for you guys. So we'll be looking at some of that content. So those are basically the three resources, GPB, PBS, and Nearpod for this particular presentation. So please do join the Nearpod, join.nearpod.com on your phone or on a separate browser, and then type that code USG. BK right there. All right, so I wanted to let you know too, besides this slideshow that I will be sharing with you all, I've also put all of your resources on this agenda. It looks like some of you have gone into it and taking a look at it. So everything we're going to be looking at today is on this agenda as well. It's just another resource for you to have. It's like a one-stop shop. It's really just a Google Doc, but you'll see that, you know, in each section that we're going to do in GPB, here's the resources we're going to be visiting, the different virtual learning journeys for the VR component. So all the VRs here, and then for the game-based learning, here's the games we're going to. So it's just another place for you to go and find the content. You don't have to go into the Nearpod, just a document you can keep forever. And it's just another source for these resources. So I wanted to make sure you have access to that. And with that, let's go ahead and get started. So I'm Tracy Wiley with GPB. I am your education outreach specialist for North Georgia. So I support 81 districts in the north, including Cobb, and always happy to be with you guys in Cobb County. Trudy and Ashley have me out a few times a year. This is the first time I'm not with you in person, but still happy to be with you on a virtual basis. And so thank you for choosing this session. I hope we'll have a lot of fun with our virtual and game-based learning resources. We all know, as our kids are apart from us, we don't have the same level of interaction. And I say, so the more interaction we can have virtually through our VR resources and through games, the better. So hopefully some of these will be new to you and inspiring and things that you can share with your kids. All right, so the goals, first of all, really just for you to be familiar with what's out there in case you're not aware, and I'm not sure, you know, what grade level or content you guys teach. So if you want to throw those out into the chat, that might help me since we're such a small group. Looks like we've got about 9 people on here, so please feel free to share your grade level and what content areas you teach. Just might help me with focusing on which games might be more relevant for you. So we're going to do that, and then we're also going to go into some ideas and teaching strategies for how to integrate these resources into your lesson plans in a virtual environment. So let's just start with why. You know, I think we all kind of know, just in terms of, you know, our it's common sense, you know, why we use games. Even as adults, right, we're all stuck in our homes, and I'm sure board games and backyard frisbee and has become much more popular these days, so and even more so for our kids. So first of all, playing games is natural. It's something they love to do in their free time. So of course, any kind of games you introduce into the classroom is going to be exciting. It's going to be minimally disruptive because of the, you know, the excitement of actually playing a game. But games are also very useful because they can present realistic scenarios and real world challenges. They're a different way of assessing because you can collect data on both, you know, the process, the skills they're learning, and also the product, you know, the information they're learning. So it's a very versatile tool for assessment. Sometimes there are skills that are used in games that we may not necessarily traditionally assess in the classroom. We'll talk a little bit about that. And then of course, you know, the big one is that they increase motivation and engagement, because whenever you bring a game, then everyone's just all that more involved. So many reasons why we would like to do game-based learning in our classroom if we can get the same outputs. Why virtual reality? So another question. Well, there's so many ways, especially now in our virtual learning environment, why this is useful. First of all, they can tour the world virtually, right? They can go pretty much anywhere that they can't visit in reality, either because they're under quarantine or because it's just too expensive to fly off to China or Australia. So world traveling is so important as a, you know, virtual reality to help us get our kids to these locations. Also, virtual time travel. We can go back in time and experience in a different way things that have already happened. So that's also an exciting way to use virtual reality. Empathy machine. There's been a lot of research that shows that virtual reality builds empathy. We especially need that now, you know, during these times as we're separated and we're experiencing so many challenges. So anything that can build empathy, of course, is welcome. So VR is another tool for that. Active autonomy, you know, students have that choice, and that's so powerful. When you use virtual reality, they can choose, you know, where to go more often than not, choose to investigate this area or go to that location. And so that choice, that autonomy is so powerful for them. And of course, part of that is immersing. Once they can make choices, they're more likely to stay in the room, you know, throughout the different aspects of it. So many reasons also why virtual reality is a powerful tool. So let me just check real quick and see where you guys are from before I launch into this next part. So it looks like we've got 10th grade world history, we have an 8th grade, secondary social studies 10th, and 9th grade geography. Okay, wonderful. Thank you guys for sharing that. So we have one 8th grader. I may do the Georgia Race Through Time again, a different time period. Just because it is such a good model for how games can work. So Diane, I hope you don't mind if you do that one more time if you were in my earlier session. We'll see how that goes. So 3 ways to use games. I really want to focus on games first, game-based learning, and 3 ways that they're especially useful, games in the classroom. First of all is information processing. So as they're learning information, how can they show you that they've learned it? And by being tested through a game is a wonderful way to showcase their knowledge. Oh, thanks, Diane, for saying it's okay. I appreciate it. Second way is modeling. So if we can't necessarily go out and do an activity or a skill, demonstrate a skill in reality, we can model it in a virtual environment. So we can show information we learned, process that information. We can model skills that we want to learn or we're trying to teach to our kids. And then a virtual reality and gaming is also a great way for sharing our experience, which is, again, more powerful as we're separated. But if we're all playing the same game together, we're all visiting the same virtual space, it's another way to connect ourselves, share our experiences, what we saw that was unique, that really stood out to us. So it's a way we can go somewhere together and share, you know, that context. So again, three different ways we're gonna sort of outline how to use these throughout this session. So the first one is games as information processing. This is where students apply their knowledge and their skills to solve puzzles and problems. And the more they do it, the more that they play the game, of course, as we know, that helps them build mastery of the skills and build understanding of the concept. Very familiar with how teenagers work. I have two teenagers in my house, and they do like to repeat the same games over and over and over again. So hopefully, you know, these games are engaging enough that they can repeat them more than once and learn and master skills as they're going. So what I wanted to share with you all first is a game from our Georgia Studies collection. And I did do this earlier with my eighth graders, but I wanted to do it a different time period at least. It's just really because it's a great model for how you can take other games and play in a virtual environment. So this is just one game, but I'm showing you how you can play it together via Nearpod. So Nearpod is the scaffolding I'm using for my slideshow. What I'm going to show you can be done at the free level. So the silver level of Nearpod, if you sign up for an account, you can do this same activity that I'm doing with you. And I'm not trying to sell Nearpod. I just think it's a great tool for this particular, you know, game-based learning. So what we're going to do is we're going to go into the Georgia Race Through Time, which is an eighth grade resource. But you know, it's useful for U.S. history as well. Similar to this game, you can still follow this approach to playing it. So this is the Georgia Race Through Time, and it is, as it says, it is a race where kids have to find their way all around the state of Georgia. So they have to understand, you know, latitude and longitude, the cardinal directions, they have to know where the Savannah River is, they have to know where the fall line is, they have to know the difference between, you know, the Piedmont and the coastal plain. So they kind of have to have a command of Georgia in order to do well in the game, because they can get lost if they don't know the difference between north and south, or they don't know the difference between the Savannah and the Chattahoochee Rivers. So they have to kind of have a command of Georgia to play the game, which is useful because we're all live in Georgia, so it can't hurt. So that's part of it, those map and globe skills. They also have to learn about Georgia history, because there are six different time periods, and they're answering questions about each different time period. And so that's what the way the game works, the character history and her dog Peaches, and you're trying to help her find those hidden artifacts around Georgia before the bad guys do, and the bad guys are adults with money and power. So that's as bad as they get. But we're trying to help her win this game and beat them to the artifacts. So what we're gonna do together is we're gonna play the game in the form of a poll. And as we're doing this, just keep in mind that even if you're not a Georgia Studies teacher, that as your kids play this particular game, if you wanna use this game, that they will be learning their map and globe skills, which is something that's important for all social studies, right? To know where we are in the world. They are gonna be practicing some of their reading standards for literacy and history, like how to identify key ideas and details, how to integrate knowledge and ideas, and they're gonna be practicing their information processing skills. So how to compare and contrast, how to organize things chronologically, how to distinguish between fact and opinion, how to interpret timelines and analyze artifacts. So these are all important skills for any level of history. Just the context of this game is Georgia Studies. So what we're going to do is I'm going to present you first with a poll here in Nearpod. And the poll is going to ask you five questions. It's going to ask you to choose 5 of 10 questions. These questions are questions you would ask a mystery figure. So imagine you've gone back in time and you meet a mystery figure from this particular period in time. And you have to figure out who this person is. And the way that you do that is by asking them questions. So there are 10 questions you can ask them, but you only get to choose 5. So here comes the skill right now. Your children have to decide which questions are the best, which ones are going to give me the best information so I can figure out who this person is. So questioning, really good literacy skill. After you've identified the 5 questions, we are going to ask them one by one. So we're going to ask the first question, and when we get the answer, the clue, we're going to use that clue to figure out who the mystery character is not. So we will have a presentation of several characters. I'm going to show you what they look like. So this is the mini game. So it doesn't take a long time finding 24 artifacts all over Georgia. And this particular one that we're doing, I think it's change in conflict. So change in conflict is the time period. So the second time period in Georgia history. Here's Savannah. She doesn't see anyone, but she feels a shadowy presence. Ooh, there's the shadowy presence. Identify yourself. So you can ask this person 5 questions. If you guess who they are, you win. Yay. She has a superpower, which she can touch any object in history, and it gives her, she can see what happened to it. We don't have that superpower, but we have mapping globe skills and literacy skills, right? So we're good. So these are going to be, you know, the folks that you can guess who they might be. There's 10 of them. So you have 10 choices, and you have 10 questions down here at the bottom. So of these 10, we're going to ask 5. And after every answer, we're going to eliminate a person, eliminate who it's not. So even though we're trying to guess who it is, we're going to do it backwards just to make it more fun and also to practice our scientific processing skills. So if we get an answer that says, you know, this person was a woman, for instance, then we're going to know, okay, it's not William T. Sherman. So we can mark off William T. Sherman. So we're going to say it's not him, but we're not going to guess who it is. We're going to save that till the end. So I hope that's clear. Do not tell me who you think it is. Tell me who you think it is not, one by one. Okay, so that's how it works. First, you're going to choose 5 questions to ask. Then after each question, we're going to eliminate one person. And then at the end, we're going to guess who it is. All right, so I have presented you all with a poll. I'm going to hide your names so no one feels embarrassed if they don't know their Georgia history. So now just look at the questions, the 10 questions, and pick 5 of them that you feel is the most useful. So pick 5 questions to ask the mystery character. And we're going to, like a democracy, we're going to pick the ones that have the most votes. And those are the ones we're going to use today in the game. So any 5 questions, and your choices will show up here on the poll, and we'll see which ones to ask. See what's happening. If you guys are able to look at your screen and look at mine, you'll see that the answers are popping up as everyone has a chance to submit their choice. And if you would like to play and you haven't had a chance, go to join.nearpod.com, type in USGBK, and then you can participate as well. All right, the questions are coming in. It looks like so far the most popular is, were you ever elected to political office? What's a word or phrase that will help me identify you? Were you born before? I think that's the Declaration of Independence. Do you have an artifact that will help me identify you? And did you ever serve in the military? These are some great questions. So it looks like everyone has had a chance to vote. So we're going to go into the game and we're going to ask these top five questions that you guys have chosen, and one by one, we're going to eliminate a character. Okay. The first question is, are you originally from Georgia? We did not choose that, so we're going to skip it. Here we go. Were you born before the signing of the Declaration of Independence? So you guys did think that would be a good question to ask. Let's see what happens. No, I was born in 1778. So there's a clue. Please, in the chat box, tell me who you think it is not. So this is going to be someone who you know was born maybe after the signing or before the signing of Declaration of Independence, because the answer is no, I was born in 1778. So this person was born after the signing of the Declaration of Independence. So tell me maybe someone who was born before, because we're trying to eliminate, we're trying to figure out who it's not. So throw out in the chat box someone who you think it is not based on that clue. Person who you think it is not based on that clue. Looks like we have someone who's going to take the plunge. So we're going to cross off Andrew Jackson. So we're going to decide it is not Andrew Jackson. If you would like to give your reason, that's even better. When I play this in the classroom, I like to ask who you think it's not and why you think it's not that person. And it may be, you know, they just are wildly guessing, or it may be, well, I know, I just read the biography of Andrew Jackson. He was born such and such time. So, you know, you'll get an idea of what your kids already know. So if you do have some information to throw in the chat about why you chose that, that would be great too. All right, so we've marked off our first person. So the second question, did we get that? No, so let's keep on going. No. We did have this one. Did you ever serve in a military force is the question. And the answer is yes. I supported the United States in both the War of 1812 and in the First Seminole War and was given the rank of Brigadier General. So that's quite a meaty clue there. So now we have two clues. So we can mark off another person based on either of those clues, either the birth date that this person was born in 1778, or the fact this person did serve in the military in both the War of 1812 and the First Seminole War, and even ranked. So let's mark off someone from this list who we know does not fit one or other of those clues. So we have another Harriet Beecher Stowe. So we are thinking Harriet Beecher Stowe did not serve in the military, was not a brigadier general. So we're gonna go ahead and mark her off. So you can see how this is going one by one. We've got three more questions, so we're gonna get through this. Were you ever elected to public office was our number one question. So the answer is yes. I was elected chief of the Lower Creek Villages. Ooh, another great clue there. So looking around at our choices, who is it not? Who do we think was not elected chief of the Lower Creek? And also maybe didn't serve in the war, maybe was born, you know, before the Declaration of Independence. We have an answer, Abraham Lincoln. So we're thinking Abraham Lincoln was not elected chief of the Lower Creek. So we're gonna mark him off. All right, so here you go, one by one. Was your chosen profession? Now we still need artifact and word or phrase. Okay, let's keep on going. Do you have an artifact that might help me identify you? The kids love this one, they always ask this one. The answer is yes. I wore a distinctive headdress in honor of my Creek culture and status as chief of my tribe. So that's information we kind of already had, but we're still building up on clues. We can use a previous clue. So anybody want to offer someone else to remove? We have removed Dred Scott. So we're going to take off Dred Scott, thinking that he was not born in 1778, that he is not a chief of the Lower Creeks, maybe did not serve in the military, or at least not in the War of 1812 and the Seminole War. So we've got one more question, guys, one more person to mark off. What is a word or phrase that will help me identify you, and that is white warrior. So we can get one more guess, and it looks like it is, yes, Dred Scott was not a native. We did Abraham Lincoln. So we've got Alexander Stevens from Mary. So let's mark off Alexander Stevens. All right, so that leaves us with Eli Whitney, William McIntosh, John Ross, Sequoia, and William T. Sherman. So these are the people that you can guess from as a group. Now, of course, that's if you know for sure that it's Harriet Beecher Stowe, because you have read her biography and you know all these things are actually about her, you can still guess for her. But as a group, together playing this game, we have decided that these are our five choices. So now what I want you to do is to go into your poll and guess who you think it is based on all of these clues that we have learned together, and we've shared our information and narrowed it down to these five people. Which one person do you think it is? Put it in the poll, and you're all anonymous, so it doesn't matter if you're wrong or if your kids are wrong. If you want to use this as an instructional hook, it's a great way to find out, you know, what they already know about a topic. And this particular strategy is very easy to do. All I did was create two polls, right? The one poll to choose a question, the second poll to choose an answer. So if you can find similar games like this that you can build in a poll format, it's a great way to play a game, you know, in a group setting like this. Maybe just introduce a game to your kids. All right, let's see what we have here. Looks like folks are still guessing. We've got about 70% of you still thinking. I don't want to give it away, so I'll not show you what most people have said. We'll give you a little bit more time to be looking at, you know, our answers and coming up with who you think it is. And let's see, we had, you know, word or phrase was white warrior. The artifact was a headdress. What else? Let's see. They elected a public office. He was elected chief, he or she. Served in a military force was yes.
I don't have a crystal ball, but I can tell you the three candidates in the 2020 presidential race.
So that is Alexa. Stop. That's funny, isn't it? That was Alexa. All right. So it looks like, what have we got here? So it looks like the number one guess at this point is William McIntosh with 28.6%. So we're going to go with that. I know some people are still thinking, or maybe they're embarrassed to answer, but we're going to go with William McIntosh. So we'll go into our Georgia Race Through Time game. We're going to choose William McIntosh. If we're right, we will get, you know, some music to congratulate us, a little bit of information about the person, him, if we're right. And if we're not, it'll say, blah, blah, and we have to start all over by asking other questions and trying again. So it just puts us back in time, but we, of course, will keep learning. So here we go, fingers crossed. Yay, it is William McIntosh. And I don't know why my music is not playing, but usually there's a song that comes on. So there's his headdress, picture of him. He was Scottish, Native American, Scottish Creek, and a little bit about his background. And of course, he's in the standards for Georgia Studies. Important figure in Georgia history and U.S. history. So that's an idea of how game-based learning can be, you know, kind of fun. So hopefully you guys got some ideas from that about how you can maybe get that going in your classroom. And that is, of course, game as information processing. And that's from our Georgia Studies collection under the Georgia Race Through Time. So the next thing I want to share with you guys is using games as modeling. So that was games as information processing, where we're trying to, you know, share and learn information, but you can also do modeling. So modeling skills and activities. So a great game that's good for that we just introduced is called Make That Paper. Just came out like less than a month ago. This particular game is really wonderful, especially for CTAE. Because it is based on the Georgia forestry industry. So it's also good for economics, you know, for some Georgia history, for science as well, because it talks about the Georgia forest industry, about sustainability, about, you know, forest products, about production. But the main goal of this is employability skills. Into the game as managers of this production site, this forest reproduction site. And it is their job as managers to receive emails, deal with some conflicts, some difficulties, to hire people and fire people. So they're trying to make their business productive, but they're also having these interpersonal relationships. So it's really great just for practicing those skills while you learn about the science of paper production, about agriculture, about CTAE. The graphics, I think, are very beautiful. This is done by Fable Vision, the same company that did the Georgia Race Through Time. And we did it in conjunction with the Georgia Forestry Foundation. So first of all, you know, you get to choose your career path. You can turn off the music if you want, if it's a little not your style. But you can see here that it welcomes you to your new career. There are different careers you can try, tree farming, tree harvesting, or mill management. So you can choose what career path you want, what character you want to be. So if we want to be like Zora, the landowner, then we can hit play here. And it talks about, you know, how our responsibilities as the landowner, what we have to do. And so then you go into the game and you have your emails that have come in. You have to respond to them, deal with some of these issues and challenges that you go through with the game. So it's actually very engaging. And a lot of the skills our kids have because they're very used to, you know, checking emails, interacting in a virtual environment, but also just helps them, you know, work on some skills they don't get the same practice with. So this is an example of modeling, you know, modeling employability skills, financial literacy skills, how to make a resume, how to respond to emails, how to work in a leadership role. So some skills they may not necessarily get on a regular basis in a classroom setting. So to check that one out, the next game I wanted to share with you guys is called Lights, Camera, Budget. If you're not aware of this, this is a lot of fun, created in conjunction with the Georgia Council on Economic Education. And this is based on the Georgia film industry. So knowing kids are really into movies and television and how they're so important here in our Georgia industries. And so in this game, they get to be a movie producer and they get to actually choose what kind of movie they want, whether it's an adventure or a romantic comedy or a horror movie. And then they go through and they have to hire the actors, choose the location, feed their crew, choose music. And so it's all part of the process of making a movie. But in order to succeed in the movie and to raise money to produce the movie, they have to answer questions about financial literacy. Once again,
Welcome to Hollywood. Turn
the music off and on if you want. But you can see that here you are in Hollywood, you're a rookie, and then when you go into it, it gives you some choices about what you want to do. And so here you can choose either comedy or horror or action. I'm going to choose horror with Gordon Beale. Some of these characters, you know, are based, of course, on real people. Then you get to choose your title. So I can do like Slay Watch. And these movies were made in Georgia, so it's kind of fun to find new references. But before I can start my movie, I have to answer questions about my personal finances. So right now, you know, I have 100. You see the money that I have up here. Let me move my panels away. So I have $100 million right now to make my budget, make my movie, but it may not be enough to pay for all the things I want to do. So I'm trying to make more money, and to do that, I have to answer questions about financial literacy. So in order to succeed in their movie, they have to understand, you know, how to invest and budget. And so again, we're modeling financial literacy, modeling budgeting skills. So someone with limited income can use a budget for which purpose? And you choose which one, you know, would help, which one they think is the best choice. And so every time you answer answer correctly, you get money in your piggy bank here. So this is for me to spend, got my little bit of money. And so I've got 5 different questions I have to answer. Every question will, I'm just gonna answer them randomly now. So, oh, that was lucky. So you can see, depending on how you answer them. Okay, so I answered 3 incorrectly and 2 correctly, so I got a little bit of money in my piggy bank, but not a lot, so I need to practice my budgeting skills, obviously, so let's see what happens. And so it says, oh goodness, my personal finance skills are bombing. If I don't stay on top of my personal budget, my movie will not be a hit. So it's, you know, it's kind of important. But I did get $4 million, not as much as I could have, but I got an extra $4 million. And so then I can go into my next part of the movie. And now I have to decide my pre-production. So where do I want to have it? Do I want to have it in Georgia, New York, Arizona, or Toronto? So there's pros and cons of each one. So I can just choose, you know, where I want to be, choose my lead actor, my supporting actor, my director. So you can see how this works. You're going back and forth between making your movie and answering personal finance questions. So at the end of the exercise, your kids should have a rating on their movie. If they did really well, they'll have a 5-star movie, woohoo! If they didn't do so well, they might have a 1 or 2-star movie. Then they can go back and they can try again. And they can model more skills, practice their financial literacy, try to make a better movie. So that's another example of modeling. For game-based learning is modeling. And then another one I want to share with you guys is from PBS Learning Media. And this is, again, another one, not from GPB, but from PBS. And this is in pbslearningmedia.org. I also put the links in there for you in the agenda. So in the agenda here, if you scroll down, you can see we did the Georgia Race Through Time, Lights, Camera, Budget, Make That Paper. And now we're on Mission US. So there are 5 of these in different periods in U.S. history this time. But we've got Cheyenne Odyssey, Flight to Freedom, For Crown or Colony, Up from the Dust, and City of Immigrants. And this is actually world history here. It's one of those standards, so that might be helpful for that. So the way these work is that you launch the game, and it's kind of like a choose-your-own-adventure game. So there's a trailer, and you are Lena. She's a Jewish immigrant from Russia, and you're trying to bring your parents to America, working in a factory for long hours. And so, of course, it's talking about, you know, this period in history, also about the immigrant experience. So a great way to make connections to current events while you're learning about this period and learning about, you know, other cultures worldwide. So it's a very powerful game. Again, you can see lots of supportive resources. And basically, I can't go into it now, but you're going to be living as her. And the choices you make influence, you know, what happens to you. So this is like a choose your own adventure game. And this particular game, when you go into these Mission US, the purpose of these is to teach hard history. So the idea, you know, is how can you, address some of these difficult situations from history? How can you experience them, talk about them, in an environment that is structured and safer for kids? So all of these, you know, are difficult choices: the revolution, the experience of enslaved people, the persecution of Native Americans and the exile of them from their homeland, the experience of immigrants in the early 1900s, the Great Depression. So some of our challenging periods in history that we need to learn about and try and develop empathy and understand some of the experiences that were happening. So again, modeling and learning at the same time. And that's kind of the summary of the game-based learning. I just want to summarize some of the things we talked about. You know, we really want to use game-based learning as much as possible because it's natural. We can present realistic scenarios like we did, you know, for Georgia history and U.S. history and economics, movie making, financial literacy, employability skills. You'll collect data that your kids are doing, how well they do on the movie, how quickly it takes them to gather all 24 hidden artifacts, how they do on as an immigrant, for instance. You have those data. And there are certain skills and choices you may not necessarily normally get from your kids. And of course, hopefully they'll be more engaged and motivated to play these games. So I want to pause right there for a minute to see if anyone has any feedback or thoughts. Let me check my chat before I get into the next section on virtual reality. So it looks like doing okay. Let me know if you have anything you'd like to add. All right, so the next section, we've got about 10 more minutes. virtual reality as shared experience. So virtual reality is really useful for sharing real world simulations, especially. So we're gonna talk about a little bit of the virtual reality that GPB sponsors. First of all, we have virtual field trips all over Georgia. And so again, those are more of a US history, Georgia slant, but you can immerse yourself in any of these situations with virtual reality. So slavery and freedom, there are VR walking tours. There are also VR videos. You'll be in a room and you can hear a narration about the room as you look around. You can touch on hotspots, learn about objects in the room. So it is an immersive experience. You can send your kids into, you know, slavery and freedom or into the civil rights movement, have them look for things. You know, the civil rights movement has, like, for instance, there's a jukebox in the diner. So for the portion about taking a stand about sit-ins, there is a three-dimensional diner or a dining room. And the kids can go into this room and they can look around. They can see objects that are on the tabletops, on the walls, on the counter. Like I said, there's a jukebox in the corner. They can play music. So it is an immersive experience as they go into these locations. Same thing with Georgia Forests. If you're looking for, you know, economics, an aspect there, regulation, so they can go and experience that. There's virtual reality aspects of that. Even things like Warm Springs and the Cherokee Nation, you can immerse yourselves in those locations. There are overhead maps where you can choose where to go at each location. And when you get to that location, again, there are virtual walking tours and rooms that you can go into. There are videos, there are primary sources, there are audio files. There's even some interactive maps and things. So it is, again, that immersive sort of self-guided tour that hopefully are especially engaging for your kids now, as you really want them to get a little bit deeper into the content and they have more time to do that on their own when you can send them into these resources. So I want to emphasize that. We also have a separate page where we've pulled the VR components out of the virtual field trips. So if you don't want to send your kids deep diving into them, you can just show them one video from, you know, different from a particular location. So here is the page for all of our VR and AR that are separate. So here's just a video from the forestry, a video from Little White House. So any of these, if you go into them, if you just click on them, it is like a VR experience at this one location of VR video. So this is the Okefenokee Swamp, for instance. You can hit play, it's less than 2 minutes long. And then you can just kind of look around.
Nestled along the eastern side of the Georgia-Florida border, the Okefenokee Swamp is a vast wetland that covers nearly 500,000 acres. A swamp is a low-lying area that is always wet and covered with a shallow layer of rainwater.
So you can see each of these videos is going to be like that. It is going to take you into, you know, the location where you'll hear a narration and you can look around. And so we have actually partnered with Georgia College on these. So some of these are GPB and some of them are Georgia College, like Flannery O'Connor's Andalusia, that's a Georgia College video. Flint River Aquarium is from Georgia College. So it was a Hardman Farm historic site. And then others of these, like Mulgee, some of these are going to be GPB. So just a great place where you can try and share different experiences with your kids in virtual reality. Also wanted to mention that there are a lot of VR explorations through PBS. Some of these are super powerful. So if you are not aware of some of these, I would definitely recommend them. They're very well done. So I'm going to go ahead and click on the PBS Learning Media YouTube channel. And you can see, you know, this one's about Greenland. This one's about the Acropolis. So there's quite a wide variety. Chernobyl. This is D-Day, Ebola. There's the Incan civilizations. Let's see, the Great Pyramid. Hagia Sophia, that's been in the news a lot lately. Mercy Street, about the Civil War. This is a very well done one. It is a letter, it's a primary source. So they're reading the letter from a soldier and you can look around the room where he died in the hospital, but you can read his last letter. It's very, very sobering, sad, but of course, right on target for the time period. So I would definitely recommend some of these. Look into, here's a China. You know that's part of world history there. China, blue jeans, globalization. My Brother's Keeper, another really powerful virtual reality. And when I say virtual reality, again, you go into these situations. So you go into the video and you can look around. And again, they're pretty.
Father doesn't talk much.
They're pretty powerful.
When he does, I wish he didn't.
This particular one is about two brothers. One served. One was a soldier in the north, and one was a soldier in the south. And they talk about their reasoning for why they chose to either fight on one side or the other. They're both from the south, but one of the sons went and fought for the north. And so it talks about. The institution of slavery, and he fought in the North because of his experience with enslaved people. So again, a very, very powerful resource there. All right, and so I just wanted to wrap up the next 5 minutes with just a little exercise, See No Wonder. This is from Harvard Project Zero, just one of many great resources they have that I believe I put into the agenda. I think I put all of our if I did not, I will add that. We have a whole section of teaching strategies for online learning. I'll make sure I add that to this if I haven't already. And this particular activity is from Harvard Project Zero. It's very simple. It's also a good way to kind of see what your kids know about a topic. So I'm just gonna play this video for you from our Civil Rights Movement virtual learning journey. I'd just like to hear in the chat box what you guys see. So just a fact, you might see this object or I see that person or this setting, what do you know about it? So something that, what's your pre-knowledge? What are you coming into the classroom knowing about already? And then what do you wonder? What does this video make you think about or question? So it's a good way, again, just to kind of know what your kids are identifying, what key ideas and details they're identifying, what their pre-knowledge is, and what they're interested in. It's a very simple, but a great teaching strategy. So go ahead and play this for everyone. And in the last few minutes, if you could just throw into the chat box what you see, what you know, and what you wonder. This is from our Civil Rights Movement virtual learning journey. It's a view of what you would see in an Oculus headset. So you could do it with Google Cardboard, or you can use an Oculus headset. And if you're into, you can use that with your phone. If you're inside the virtual learning journey, this is what it looks like. So the Oculus headsets have these wands, and you can point to things and click on them. Oculus headsets, they're about $200 each. It's not something that we sell, but again, if you're looking for that for your kids, that's what it costs. Google Cardboard, of course, are $10 or less. So here they are inside a classroom, a segregated classroom from the 1950s. They're looking around. Everything that sparkles is something you can interact with. So if you interact with the board, you'll see, Ruby Bridges, her background. There's the map. I believe that's Freedom Riders, the map of the Freedom Riders. So it talks a little bit about this. So everywhere they click on something, it expands into more knowledge. So they can just go into any room and explore it. Here is there's the jukebox in the corner I mentioned. This is the diner. See the artwork on the walls. That is artwork from the Civil Rights Movement. There's a camera with photographs, primary source photographs. There's a cassette tape, they may not know what that is, that has interviews from Freedom Riders. There's a ticket that will take you on a map of the Freedom Rides from the north to the south. So it's just another way to learn the content with a more immersive. And again, your kids can all go into these same places and explore them separately, but together. This is in the Oval Office. It talks about the laws, the Civil Rights Act, and the Voting Rights Act. You see that the Oval Office has changed a bit. This is, of course, from that time period. You can see those primary sources. So again, just another way to get your kids into the content. And we have, these are available for the Owens Thomas House and for Civil Rights Movement and for the Forests of Georgia. And of course, Oculus Go has other free resources as well for world history, for instance, from PBS Learning Media. So let's hear what you guys have seen. Anything you want to throw out there, see, think, and wonder in our last minute. See what you got from the chat. And then while you're doing that, just going to throw this out here for our last minute to see if there's any last questions, comments, or observations, you know, see, think, wonder from that video to throw out before we wrap it up for the day. Thank you guys for playing the game. And I hope you did get some ideas, or maybe found out about some new strategies or new resources you didn't know about. And I will be, as I mentioned, sending everyone a copy of the agenda, this Nearpod presentation, and I'm sharing a copy of the recording with Cobb County as well. If there are any questions that you have, please just email me back. Let me know if you have questions or feedback or any ways I can help you as you go into this new school year, guys. I know you have a lot on your plate. So best wishes, good luck, and have a great school year. And please do let me support you, reach out however I can. Thanks so much. Enjoy the rest of your afternoon. Go and crash. It's a long day. My pleasure. Thank you, guys. And hopefully I'll get to see you all soon. Get out to Cobb County again soon. Stay safe out there, guys. You're welcome. Keep an eye out for that follow-up email. With all this, so you can take it at a much slower pace. I know that I went super fast. I'm sorry about that, guys, but I'll send you all this stuff so you can look at it again at your own time, hopefully help you out. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and wrap it, go ahead and close it out at 3:20 and let you guys go home. Thanks so much, everyone. Bye-bye.